Hello, so thank the organizers for letting me talk. I didn't know I was recorded that way, but that's a bit stressful. But, so this is going to be a theoretical talk about evolutionary rescue in a simple phenotype fitness landscape. And it's basically a summary of three papers, two done by Johan Ancio, who was in PhD with Ophélie Rons, who is here, and I. And I even took some of his slides. Probably the nice ones, I hope. And then another paper by Mathieu Osmond, who was in PhD, not with me, but with Sally Otto at UBC Canada. And the three other collaborators were involved in this, Amaury Lambert from University Sorbonne, Lionel Roch, who is just introduced me, and Luis Miguel Chevin from the CEF lab in Montpellier. Alors, comme ça, ça marche? Non. So this is, I won't give details of derivation, but mostly a modeling strategy, because there are three papers, it would be too long and boring, I guess. So first, some questions that are asked and that we also ask on the subject of evolutionary rescue in general. Then the key model assumptions and the tools we used to derive analytical results. And then some of the biological results, so theoretical biological results. So first, evolutionary rescue. So it's been introduced already by Mathieu this morning. So the main idea I want to stress is that this would be population size versus time, and this would be mean growth rate of the population versus time. And so in some cases, so you have a population facing a lethal stress, meaning it's decaying on average initially, and in the absence of any evolutionary change, it would go to extinction. And rescue is when this doesn't happen and it goes up again. And at the same time, the growth rate evolves by adaptive dynamics, and it's increasing up to a point where it becomes zero, and so the population can shift to growing, and then to some value afterwards. There is not a feedback, but there is just one effect of adaptation on demography. And I will not be treating the other important feedback that can happen in some systems where demography itself feeds back on adaptation. So there will be no density dependence and no frequency dependence in the models. And what is important to see here is that what really counts in rescue is the transient dynamics and not the ultimate equilibria. So you may have something that would reach a lower fitness in the end, but still rescues because it evolves earlier to a positive growth rate. So the challenge in the evolutionary dynamics part is to deal with the transient dynamics, I would say. So an example just to get ideas of what can be measured in this. So this is data from my lab. We've not published things here yet, but I hope to do it quite soon now. We use luminescence, which is a production of light by Escherichia coli bacteria here. And luminescence has the advantage that only live cells produce light because it's an active process needing ATP. So you can see the bacteria die and go down, which is not always the case with other measures. And so this is time, and this is over a weekend, actually, it's automatic. And these are three different treatments. One has no drug. One has a lethal but low dose of drug, ampicillin. And one has a higher dose of drug. So you can see the kind of thing that happens. The control goes up. So this is log scale, so roughly proportional to population size. And it goes up, and then to some stationary phase, which can be weird with luminescence. But the key thing is what happens all this the way here. So from that, you can measure the birth rate, assuming a pure birth process, the birth rate of the initial wild-type cell in the system. And then for the other treatments, you can see that it goes up, and then it decays. So you can also measure on several replicates, these are also replicates, can measure the decay rate. So that's another parameter that can be accessed. And you can see how the drug dose, in our case, is a way to tune the level of stress you get. And then on the longer term, dynamics change. So we have some, for example, here we have all the replicates stay extinct. This is just artificial noise. And one population shows a rebound, which is a priori rescue. And another case with lower drug dose, stress is lower, and there are more populations that show rescue with various growth rate up. So that's we can have access to all this level of precision in dynamics. So the theory of rescue, when applied to bacteria in test tubes, has potentially a lot to say on data. So it's one thing I like about it. And it's also applied potentially, but these are really nice bugs. They are not dangerous. And it's in the test tube. Now, talking also about what I'm not going to talk about, there are many ways to tackle rescue, so ER, evolutionary rescue, especially based on the genetic basis of ER, from very narrow one to a very wide one with many different co-segregating genotypes at the same time. And actually, the early treatments by, for example, Gomukiewicz and Holt, Richard is here, did models of both types, although I guess the one with wide basis is more known, it was treating both. And then there has been different adaptations of this in later publications, first considering a more stochastic based treatment with just standing variants, and that's a famous one is by Orr and Unkles, several papers, de novo mutation occurring, recombination with a paper by Hildegard, who will not talk about this, but who is here if you want to talk about it. Hildegard Baker, sorry. And also immigration, which is also treated by Richard and Holt. And actually, I think the first rescue model was done by Luria and Delbrook in 43, but although it's not so much known in our field, it was dealing with the evolution of resistance to phages, and it was probably the first stochastic model of decay and rescue. So we're going to treat here only this subset, so no recombination, no immigration, pure asexuals in isolated populations. And we're going to try to deal with both mutation and standing genetic variants. So first thing, on the genetic basis of rescue, one thing that people have studied substantially is whether the rescue comes from de novo mutations, so occurring after the onset of stress, and whether it comes from standing variants already present before the stress is imposed. This is a case of abrupt change, and I've not said it, but I'm going to talk only about a shift, an abrupt shift for this talk. So with an abrupt shift, you get, for example, population stable, you input the stress, the wild type decays, roughly exponentially here, because it's density independent, and some mutant arises from the wild type, de novo, here during the drop, and has a stochastic phase and then goes up to invade. And when standing variance occurs, you get the same thing, but the mutant was already present here. So in both cases, in fact, detecting it by pure population size dynamics is not so easy because they look roughly the same, and the noise here does not allow so much differentiation on the time of appearance. There's too much noise demographically to say the mutation dates back in the past or in the future compared to T0. Another question that can be asked is whether rescue occurs by a single mutation, which is all we've seen so far, at least in what we've seen in the previous slide, or if it occurs by two-step, for example. So what can happen is that your wild type produces first a mutant that is destined to get extinct, either because it's subcritical or because it's supercritical, but among those guys who are not lucky. And this transient genotype, which we call springboard, will produce a secondary mutant that goes up. And the same can be studied in the case of standing variants, a transient standing variant that produces a de novo mutant. So this will be two-step rescue versus the other one was a one-step. So here also we may wish to detect these empirically from the pattern that is a bit different. But again, if you look at the actual stochastic process, it's not necessarily obvious. It's not maybe the most direct way to access these distinctions. Now, to deal with those different genetic bases can be done in several models. And the way we will model the probability of rescue will depend a lot on how we consider the likelihood that the wild type produces a transient mutant or a rescue mutant, and how it depends on the stress. Say you assume a stronger stress goes fast, quicker to extinction, for example. But stress can also have other effects than just decay faster. It can also affect how you are likely to mutate to resistance, because if you're bad, you're not well adapted to a strong stress, you have less chances, that's empirically seen quite a lot, to produce a mutant that resists this stress. So this is a part that is not the purely demographic aspect, but the context-dependent mutation aspect of it. And to deal with this part, one of the actually historical model of rescue, for example, the works of Lynch and Landy, or Berger and Lynch with a continuous change in the environment, or with abrupt change in Holt and Gomulkiewicz, or Gomulkiewicz and Holt, is to use fitness landscapes. So these works were done on phenotype fitness landscapes, and they were using deterministic approximation and considering a sexual population. So here is the graph. So imagine that this is growth rate versus some phenotype, which may be multivariate or univariate. And there is an optimum in the past in the environment before stress that is here. And your wild type is, say, around the optimum, close to this. Or there's standing variance around this optimum. And you do an abrupt change. You could also move it continuously, so that the fitness function relating phenotype with growth rate shifts to another place. So the new optimum is here now. And if zero is here, zero growth rate, the shift can be sufficient that your wild type now has a negative growth rate. And this wild type is here, so you can read its negative growth rate here. It's going to be minus RD. So RD is the decay rate of the wild type, the slope of my log scale before. And the R max would be the height of the peak. So it's how high can the growth rate be given the constraint, the local constraint that there is. And your mutant is somewhere in between, or there, anywhere. So wherever you put your mutant phenotype, which is a shift mutating from this point to somewhere else, and you can read its growth rate. And so the rescue mutants are in this area of phenotype, the area that is above zero here. So that's quite a natural visual way to do it. There's all other reasons to use this, this approach, but I don't have too much time to show the data. At least one point interesting is that the resistance probability among mutants, the decay dynamics of the wild type, all these emerge from the model. So they are not separate things and they are covariant. So whether this covariance is valid or not empirically is an open question, but at least the properties emerge from the assumption. And also it connects to a lot of the literature on evolutionary ecology when considering gradients of more or less strong stress in space or time. To implement this idea of a strong or weak stress, we usually use those landscapes. The optimum is far or is close, and it's a strong stress or a mild stress. So there is an interest in looking at it from this perspective. The goal of what we've done in this paper is to derive the corresponding asexual models, because there are many tools we can't use here, like the infinitesimal model, constant variance of traits. So we have to come up with something else, and also to try to make a more stochastic treatment of it. Now the assumptions, main assumptions of the model. So first we use a particular form of a phenotype fitness landscape, which is isotropic Fischer's geometrical model. So it's Fischer's geometrical model, not Fischer's infinitesimal model. For growth rates, so here, for example, growth rate would be this. It's actually a quadratic function, so this is not perfect. Now wild type is there and produce mutants around it. And among those mutants, those who are on the green part, they are rescuers because they have positive growth rate. So RD is given by here and R max is the height of the spike. So there are a few parameters here. There is a dimension of the landscape, the step size, which is the typical variance of mutation effects, the peak height, which is how high you are here, the genomic mutation rate overall, not including just resistance, and a stress intensity, which is connected to how far you go when you shift the optimum. We make two assumptions. First, selection is isotropic quadratic, so the farther from the optimum you are, the lower the growth rate. So it's again frequency density independent. And mutation has a Gaussian effect around the parental type. So wherever you are, you mutate by doing a Gaussian displacement in multivariate in n dimension. It evolves according to a Poisson process with additive effects, so multiple mutations add up on phenotype, but not on fitness. So it's fairly classic model, I guess. So what the point, I said it before, it's the model has mixes the different aspects of rescue, so the decay rate, the genetic basis of resistance, the proportion of resistance, their growth rate in the stress, their cost in the past, all together are handled by the parameters of the model. And also the stress intensity itself, the decay rate, they're all mixed together by the landscape model. There are also some useful analytical things. So although the model produces quite complex patterns of mutation effects across environments or across backgrounds, it has been dealt with for a long time, and it has some simple results that we can use analytically. For example, we know the distribution of the growth rate of mutants, random mutants, given the growth rate of the parent. So it has a simple, semi-simple, non-central chi-square distribution. Also, we have some explicit standing variance scenarios. So when we start to deal with pre-existing variants, we must have a scenario for what the shape of this variance is. So one natural option, maybe not the best, but one natural option is to use the mutation selection balance. So we assume we're at mutation selection balance before the stress around the former optimum. And in this case, we have two extreme treatments. We don't, at least I don't know, of a general overall treatment of what the standing variance will be. But there are two extremes that can be dealt with. First, a strong selection, weak mutation regime, where the mutation rate over the mutation effects is less than some conjectured threshold due to dimension. In this case, the equilibrium has a spike at the optimum, plus a tail that is analytic, and the spike has a known weight given by the harmonic mean of selection coefficients. This is just for n more than 2, but it can be there is a result for n equals 1 and 2. And then there is a weak selection, strong mutation regime, where it's more polymorphic. Both are polymorphic equilibria, but this one is more polymorphic. This is then when u over lambda is strongly above, in theory it must be strongly above this threshold. And then the distribution at mutation selection balance is Gaussian then, but not due to an infinitesimal model effect, more to an accumulation of mutations, doing a sort of central limit theorem too. And we know also the variance and all that from the parameter. So this is useful to create an analytic scenario for the standing variance case. And finally, only in the weak selection, strong mutation regime, mostly there, we have also the dynamics of the mean fitness. If you didn't have any demography, just adaptation in constant population, what is the dynamics of your mean fitness over time? And it also has an analytic form of a relatively simple form. This term is the convergence towards the optimum over time, and this form, this part is the buildup of the mutation load when you start from a clone here. So this is why it's called DN for de novo. You see that. Then we have to make assumptions on the demographic process and the stochastic demographic process. So there are several demographies that can be used. We are dealing with non-density dependent process with the assumption that everything important happens at low population sizes where we can ignore density dependence. And so we take a diffusion approximation to density independent processes, which can apply either to discrete generation with like annual plans or to birth-death processes. This is a common approximation to it. Here, caution, there are many works done even by people in this room about taking formal limits properly. Here, we're just using the results. So read the literature about it. And then what can we do with this? So why take this assumption rather than the pure birth-death process, for example? What we will use is it's a stochastic differential equation describing the dynamics of each lineage I over time t. So this is a classic Feller SDE, and they are independently growing. So it's a multi-type Feller process. And we authorize the growth rate to change over time and also the stochastic variance, but in a deterministic fashion, not stochastically. And this demography can approximate several subcases. For example, a discrete time model with a Poisson number of offspring every generation. If you have a small growth rate compared to one, so per generation growth rate is small, then the growth rate and the sigma, so the variance is roughly close to one, and the mutation rate by construction in discrete time is constant across lineages and across time. And you have an approximation of this. You can also treat a birth-death process over time in continuous time by approximating it, provided that, for example, you consider that effects mostly affect death rate, not birth rate. This is to assume that your mutation rate is constant because it depends on the birth rate otherwise. And you have your growth rate again, and your sigma is roughly close to twice this constant birth rate. These are two examples. For the moment, we have not published at least things with variation in mutation rate or in stochastic variance across genotypes. So what happens is mostly mutations and environments affect the growth rates, not the mutation rate and reproductive variance. So there are some useful results with the Feller. Some exist also with the birth-death, but this one does not. So first, there is analytic results for the probability of ultimate extinction given an initial start point for any lineage. I've dropped the reference to the index I here. There is also an interesting property on the terminal variable, which is how the population size will be distributed among the non-extinct over a long time. So that's also helpful. And there is also analytical results on the cumulative size of a given lineage. So the integral of the pop size over time. So why is it useful? Well, this is obviously useful to computing extinction probability. We're in density independent process, so non-extinction is rescue. And also the computing the extinction time distribution, because this is given for any time, so we know the waiting time to extinction. This is useful because it can give us long-term trajectories info, so on what we observe over the longer term. And this is very useful because when we deal with multi-step rescue especially, it's all about the intermediate step is stochastic from the beginning to the end. It starts in one copy mutant and it gets in small size until it goes to extinction. And the stochasticity in this must be captured. And here there is a nice tool with the continuous state process, which is the Lamperti transform, which provides an explicit expression for this. I'm skipping the actual result, but it's all explicit given R of t and sigma of t. If you want to see it, I'll show it back. So from there, we have two strategies depending on two extremes. We don't have an overall treatment over the spectrum of mutation rates. So we've seen that with Fisher's model, there are different behavior where mutation rate over effect is strong or is small. So in the first extreme, we have a strong selection, weak mutation, rare mutants arise. So we consider a very narrow distribution of growth rates, and there are random mutations occurring, and they have either they get extinct or they do a selective sweep. So this is when U over lambda is strictly below this. So in this case, polymorphism is not too big. So every replicate population will have 1, 2. We'll see that 3 and 4 don't count too much, at least in what we've studied. So there is not too much polymorphism to handle in each replicate. So we deal with every lineage as a stochastic but homogeneous Fehler process. And with this, we can derive results on the probability of rescue by a single step mutant or by two steps. Standing variance, as we are here, we know its form, and it has a spike plus a tail, so we can deal with it this way. In the other extreme, with a high mutation rate, the strategy is different because we could accumulate many, many mutants over time in every lineage, so we cannot follow each of them as a stochastic process. But on the other hand, because there is a high mutation rate, evolution can tend to be quite deterministic even when we get close to the extinction. And so what we do here is we consider evolution as deterministic, following the trajectory of growth rate expected in a large population, and demography is the only thing that creates extinction. So basically, you're going down and up, and it's when you're down, it's the stochastic demography that kills you. Of course, in simulations, we don't do that. And so then, in an infinitely small time, there is an infinite polymorphism, because these are all diffusion approximation. And standing variance, then, is Gaussian. So again, other simulations don't do that, it's just the analytic model strategy. Our simulations were done in discrete time in this case. So yeah, that's the strategy. Fehler, homogeneous Fehler. Here this is inhomogeneous Fehler, sorry, because the growth rate will change. It's like one population with a given deterministically changing growth rate. And that's the strategy. So some results, we have 10 minutes? Or 5, but we didn't start at 30. So first some, so these are all discrete time individual based simulation with a Poisson number of offspring. So this is the probability of rescue versus the decay rate. So how strong is the stress? This is the main thing we looked at. So this is a simulations with everything. We can have many mutants or a single, but we are in a parameter range where we expect to be in the SSWM regime. And we just model the one step ER. And in this case, it's sufficient to consider the one step rescue. And you can see that the theory is quite, quite okay. So this is from de novo. So we started with a clone initially. Then if you add an initially polymorphic population at mutation selection balance in the same regime, you add, in fact, you just shift this curve over bigger decay rates. So you can handle higher decay rates, but it's quite proportional. And so then you have another expression for the evolutionary rescue, which has a rescue rate due to de novo plus one due to standing variance. And you can actually know the probability of contributions from standing versus de novo mutants in this case, because it's simple. Then there's another result that, in fact, if you assume that the mutation effects are small compared to the basic growth rate of the genotype, you can simplify the expression and come up with an effective stress measure, which depends on the decay rate, the peak height, and the mutation effect. And this effect is interesting because it can handle different ways of doing the shift. So the shift can be just shift the optimum by the stress, but it can also shift the optimum plus lower the peak height, or it can shift the optimum plus change the mutation effects. And all this comes into a single parameter. So you can see here those three scenarios when you do PR against stress give different curves, but when you plot it against the alpha parameter, it's the same curve. So then two steps. I'll go quickly on this one. The thing to remember, these are against simulations, and these are theory. This is the total rescue probability versus wild type growth rate. And roughly, if you take just the first and second step, you have almost everything you need. So the four and three step never contribute much. But between the first and second, two step and first step, there is a shift. With strong stresses, the two step rescue become more important because it's so hard to go to the optimum that usually you have a springboard intermediate. There are several ways to be a springboard intermediate. There are some who are intermediate and subcritical. They are before they get extinct, they surely produce the second mutant. Some are critical, so they are just not decaying, either growing. They will certainly get extinct, but they are slow to get extinct. And some are supercritical, so they are destined to be a rescue of their own, but they lose the bet by just random demography. And the contribution of each of these different types of rescue intermediate depends on both the wild-type growth rate and the mutation rate. There is kind of a transition between this SSWM and so weak strong selection to weak selection models. They are kind of complementary. And so here is a simulation again in a regime where now we have a strong polymorphism. So it's completely different analytic approach. And always we have a sharp decay of priority with growth rate. This is again the same kind of thing with standing variance added. You get a larger range of decay rates that you can handle, stronger stresses, but otherwise it has the same shape. What is added when you consider WSSM, so many mutants, is that because you handle polymorphism, there is a mutation rate above which you start to die of your own, because you have so many mutations that you die because of your mutation load. So this handles the continuum about this. In this case, you can also have access to the distribution of extinction times of those populations who got extinct. This is only true in the WSSM approximation, using those inhomogeneous Feder diffusions. And these are simulations, the green things, so it gives quite good, gives a hint. And finally, you have some stress in the strong mutation regime. Some stress cannot be overcome. This is, so in blue to orange, it's the probability of rescue. And this is stress level here. And you can see that, in fact, when stress is too large, you would need a very high mutation rate to overcome it fast enough, to adapt to it fast enough. But this mutation rate is so high that you're killing yourself by mutation load. So there are some, realistic or not, it's an open question, but in theory, there are some stresses that you cannot handle by increasing your mutation rate. So some robust results. First, we often have something of this form. This is quite natural because we assume the dependence between lineages, so we have something that looks like this. The rate of rescue, so this term, will be proportional to mutation rate only for one-step rescue. For two-step or for WSSM, it's not true, of course. There's always a quite sharp increase in this rate with decay rates. So there is really a transition from stresses that you handle perfectly without extinction, and just behind it, bam, everybody's dead. So there is a sharp decay. So that's quite observed empirically, but it's an open thing. And then the range of, well, covers all the range. Standing variance, for these results at least, merely scales up the results. So the limits, of course, or extension. First, what happens at the transition? It's frustrating to be using extreme cases. So around this value, it's quite open. We'd like to introduce sexual reproduction and especially partial selfing because of the weeds, for example, problems. Maybe the infinitesimal model, it has some similarities because it's putting a Gaussian deviation around a parental mean. So it has some similarities with mutation in this framework. So maybe there are things we can do with this. Of course, there is also dealing with both birth and death rate effect, not just death rate in the birth-death explicit. Anisotropy is when you have not circles, but ellipse, and that can change things a lot because not only distance to the optimum matters, but also direction. So there are some analytical treatment possible, mostly in WSSM. Density dependence, so to keep inside this diffusion approximation for demography, there is a tool which is logistic CB process, which has almost as many results, including a Lamperti transform. So maybe there's a way to do it this way. Moving optimum is, again, WSSM is doable quite, roughly we've done it. SSWM, not so much. Source sync is when you include migration from a source. Again, this is all doable easily in WSSM, but my problem is that I think the most realistic in many conditions is the SSWM. So the less handy is also the one that makes more sense, I guess. And something. Oops. I'm cheating. I'm putting my last slide behind me. So, that
so are there any questions?
So I'm by no means an expert in that field. I dealt with some similar models in cancer research, in which you have a multi-clone population and then there are clones which are more resistant and so on and so on. Now there's always this issue as to whether after, say in leukemias after chemotherapy, which is similar to your treatment model, except it's just a pulse. You suffer relapse due to either emergence of a new clone or simply exist pre-existence of it, so standing variation in a way. Now I have the following question, because it's not strictly analogous, not identical, there are some analogies. But so in your model, if you take this population of bacteria and then you increase selection level by introducing an agent, right? Antibiotic with given concentration. Then you keep it at this concentration, right? So new standing, mutation selection balance arises, which is probably narrower, right?
Not really. Once you've avoided extinction during the transition phase, you rebuild a new mutation selection balance that is just around the new optimum, but it's the same mutation selection balance. But what you say about the drug treatment is really, I think cancer and bacteria, I mean, and potentially viruses, it's all asexual. Roughly.
No,
cancer is maybe
the
only
here,
true asexual we know, actually. But what you say about this dose effect, this is really this moving optimum extension. So extension. even in my data, my growth rate goes up for hours before it decays, whereas I've put the stress at the very beginning of the experiment. So even in vitro, when I impose, I put drug in the tube, the effect due to probably diffusion, etc., is not instantaneous. So really dealing with the optimum movement is important. That's why we've done the extension with a moving optimum. Basically, the tools you have here, you can use them with a moving optimum, not linearly moving, more optimum that goes away and back like this. So the whole thing about dose treatment, this is the next step I'm trying to do, and we're doing with Lionel, because It's the whole thing about decay rates is how we can tune the optimization of the drug dose, many pearls or big pearls, etc. And so I don't think there is, maybe I'm not answering your question.
I'm not sure if I'm getting it right, but it seems to me that the fact that you are getting the same variation is due to the fact that your mutations are either advantageous or disadvantageous symmetrically, right? So they are, the effect is side both ways. Random, okay. But actually, there are less mutations that are advantageous than mutations which are disadvantageous, because most mutations are slightly deleterious.
Yeah. So being advantageous or deleterious is quite context dependent. If you have data on single mutation effects measured in different environments, you can get guys who are beneficial, and in another environment with like a bit of 2 degrees more, they are lethal. There are actual data showing this. So this is really context dependent on the data. You know? And so, for example, we did experiments where we adapted to different doses, lines, for long term, and you have a very different pattern just after the screen for resistance and what happens over 400 generations in the same dose. You see local adaptation rising with the guys adapted to dose 2 being better, the guys adapted to those 100. Whereas at the beginning, the guys adapted to those 100 were better than everybody. But this, there are several ways to model that, but the kind of approach here does it, because here, half mutations are on both sides. But when you're at the optimum, actually all mutations are deleterious. And when you're away from the optimum, almost half of them are beneficial. But as your population advances here, the kernel of fitness effects becomes strongly negative. So it's because this is the phenotype. The fitness is nonlinear with phenotypes. So you have a complete change. There is epistasis everywhere. So once you're at the end here, all your mutations are deleterious in this new environment.
I'm sure as they have to look at your papers. But one very brief question. So the data that you are referring to are mostly from bacteria, right?
On cancer, I've discussed with Robert Nobel. You know Robert Nobel, maybe?
Sure.
Robert Nobel. He works on cancer. I've discussed with him, but it's more difficult to run evolution experiments on cancer cells. We have some models of cancer cells where you can control replicates, etc. But it's a bit more difficult. You need to put them in the right conditions to grow, whereas we just need sugar and that's done. There are some data on yeast. What we don't have is rescue on actual bugs, Drosophila plants. But on bacteria, there is a substantial literature on drug effects, but they're not following so much. I mean, the decay rate measurement is done, the rescue purity is done, and for the whole PhD of Johan, I was hoping we would find decay rate and rescue purity together in the same data set, and we didn't find any, which is too bad because it would be a good way to test the model. But the cancer data, I'm not expert, but I know it's more difficult to run just to make them live on the lab, basically.
Thank you.
Are there other questions? So if not, let's thank the speaker again.